Hello, everybody, and welcome to the world of paleoanthropology. This is Seth and Smudge, my new puppy. We're going to be recording today's episode. The new episode of Skulls with Seth is what we'll be discussing today, and we're going to be learning about Australopithecus sediba. A little hard to see right here because of the lighting, since it's white. Most of my prints are in a little different color, but we will do our best here. And so this fossil has a very fun story behind it, and we're going to talk about that as well as talking about the morphology of the skull as well as the species and learn a little bit about it. And unlike most of my other fossil cranium, I actually have postcrania for this species, which I will be showing you towards the end. I think it's one of my favorite prints and it's very exciting. And we'll take a look at that. So, who is Australopithecus sediba and how did we come to know this species? And of course, as usual, I'll be giving you a close up as I start talking. But before we do that, notice this skull is not out of the matrix. Which, if you don't know what that is, the matrix is what it's found in. So, this kind of chunky white part that's attached to the skull, that is rock. That's the rock that the skull is still in. The excavators decided that they could not get the skull out without causing any further damage to it. And of course, when we're dealing with fossils that are so rare and so important to our shared human origins, we don't want to damage them. So this skull, MH1, Malapa hominin 1, because it was discovered in Malapa, South Africa, became to be known as Australopithecus sediba. This little fella here is a juvenile who, while we don't know exactly how he died, he was found with a female, MH2, who the later remains that we're going to look at belong to her. And we don't know if there was a maternal relationship between this juvenile and the adult female, but of course there could have been since they were located so closely together. But there's just so much left for us to learn. This little guy here is named Carabo in the local language, and he's just a beautiful specimen. He's also known as a skull in the rock. Just take a good glance at him there, hold that. So, how did we come to find out about this species? This is a fun story. It's a little different than the other stories you hear. So, one day back in around 2009, 2008, Dr. Lee Berger, who we all know from the Homo naledi discoveries as well as many other publications, is teaching at the University of Witwatersrand in South Africa. He was doing some new work where he had, as he would put it, discovered Google Earth, probably the last person on the Earth to do so, as he says. And he found that there was a way for him to discover what would most likely be cave sites in the local area, and especially in his quote backyard, the cradle of humankind. And he found a few locations that he was going to check, and one day he went and took his son and their dog. And a few other gentlemen, I believe, to this location, Malapa, which was an old mining site. There was a giant pit in the ground that had been blown out by dynamite. And they arrived and they were going to look for fossils. And Lee told his son, Matthew, who is a few years younger than myself, to go look for fossils. And what he did, I'm sure Professor Berger was not expecting much, maybe an antelope fossil, something common that was in the area. And what does little 9-year-old or 8-year-old Matthew do? He yells out, "Dad, I found a fossil." And Professor Berger comes over and looks at what his son got, and he turns it over, and it's a hominin clavicle, which no one is probably better prepared to look at hominin clavicles than Dr. Berger because he did his dissertation on them. So he saw this immediately, and they were on the hunt. Matthew had found something amazing. He had found what would turn out to be a site that was extremely rich in fossils and of that which we didn't know existed from a species we didn't know lived in that area or even known to the fossil record. sediba, as it was later named. And this is a smaller species, about a little bigger than Lucy, I would say. And they stood, they didn't stand very tall, but they walked upright. And they had long grasping fingers for climbing in trees. And their spines, which we would find out a few years ago, were actually much more similar to ours than we would ever guess from a creature from 2 million years ago, which is where they date to. Then we would have expected a much more ape-like spine, but it actually has a lower lordosis, which is the curve that we have in our spines in our lumbar region. And sediba had them as well, which I'll show you in a little bit. But we were able to discover this. It's in pieces, so let me get this together. The good one is at home where I wouldn't break it even further. But it'll also give a better idea of the general size of these hominins. So you can see the pelvis is quite small, but it's a pelvis. It's definitely recognizable as something that a hominin would possess, but not only that, but an upright walking hominin. Again, it's in pieces, so it's a little hard to show you. So here's the bottom, and we can see the coccyx and where that would be in the lumbar and the sacrum. We see the hip and the flaring angles, the sides, everything that we would see in a modern day walking Homo sapien. Of course, much smaller. Here's my hand for scale, and this is printed to scale, so I can almost hold what would have been the bowl of the pelvis in the palm of one of my hands. Very small creatures, but very important creatures. Because when they were discovered, it was first believed that they could have been the last australopith before we emerged as Homo in the evolutionary timeline. But we're doubting that now, and we believe there might have been something else in there, and Australopithecus could have been a side branch that just didn't go anywhere, which, as we know, happens with so many hominin and hominid species, as well as every other taxa on this planet. And here are some close-ups of their vertebrae. They're very obviously screwed up from being in the matrix and in the rocks. This piece in particular is still very glued together, you could say. All of these are from the lumbar part of the spine. So you've now gotten a good and an interesting look at Australopithecus sediba, both its cranium, its head, as well as its lower spine. We've talked about the story of how it was discovered, but what does this all mean for the future of science, for the future of discovery? Well, I think we've already seen what it means and what it's going to continue to mean. The discovery of sediba launched for many people a new era of exploration where fossils could still be found, where it was still a good idea to go into the field and get more fossils. The fossil record needs to be filled out more. And for decades, it was being said that there were no more fossils, which to certain professionals was a ridiculous idea. And what did they do? They went out and found them. And what happened a few years after sediba was discovered? Homo naledi was discovered. Homo luansensis, the hobbit, was discovered previously before that. I mean, so many species have been discovered, and some that even have yet to actually be designated, such as the Denisovans. For those of you who might not know, Denisovans are not actually a species because we only have such small fragments that it's not actually enough to define a taxa or a species. But once we do have more fossils, they'll probably be designated as Homo Denisovans. I'm not sure what they're exactly going to call them, obviously, but there's a few others that are like that. Homo doliensis, that's waiting to be certified as the official name for a species that could include some Denisovans or Dragon Man, as we call him, the Harbin skull that we've talked about with Chris Stringer quite a bit, Professor Chris Stringer. But there's just so much that there's left to learn and discover. And I think sediba and just the innocence in how Caraba was discovered really cements the idea that paleoanthropology is not going anywhere, that there's a bright future here for anyone who's involved, and you just have to want it. And if you want it, you will find it. I think that's all for this episode. We're going to call it a day. Stay tuned for the next episode of Skulls with Seth. I'm also going to be having other shows and episodes come up for my other series, as well as some cool things such as the discussion and creation of a new book club that I'll be hosting with the help of some people. So if you're interested in that, please let me know in the comments. And if you like this video, leave a like. If you want to see further ones, subscribe. And don't forget to turn on notifications so you don't miss any of my future videos. Anything that you leave as a tip on the channel goes to supporting SciComm and science education, because all of this doesn't pay for itself, and anything helps. And it all goes back to you guys. So have a great day. I'll see you next time.